All right, well, this morning we're going to do something a little different. So my family and I were on vacation last week. That's why I wasn't here last Sunday. And so we spent the week in Hillbilly Heaven, a.k.a. Branson. That's why I've got that Branson glow. If you see a glow, that's what it is. And it's not the Holy Spirit, it's the Branson glow. And coming back off of vacation, I'm here, but I'm not going to speak. So for some of you, you know, you're ready to dive back into Isaiah. So next week, we'll be back in Isaiah chapter 39. For those of you who had questions on where we are as we continue our journey through the book of Isaiah. Having said that, I know some of you will say, well, you're here. Why aren't you speaking? You only work one day a week as it is. And I understand that sentiment. But the truth is that as a pastor or a shepherd, very little of what I do is this. This is just what gets seen. So a couple times a year, I like to take the opportunity to be here on Sunday mornings, but to not be on, not be doing it, not be a pastor, to get to be where you guys are. And so this morning, we're having a guest speaker. And what happens is I get here in the morning, I go to intercessory prayer like I normally do, but then I get to hang out in the foyer and then come in and worship first service. I was sitting right over there and I got to be here. I think you're going to love what's going to be presented to you here in the next 30 minutes. Got to be a part of that. And then I'm going to go down as soon as I'm done introducing our guest speaker, and I'm going to hang out with the youth in the children's church. You get to see a ton of people being fed spiritually down there, to get to see what the teachers are doing and how the kids are receiving and just get to be a part of that. Secondly, the person that's going to speak is Alana Warenberg. And Alana grew up in our church, and then she's 5 years removed from high school, right? And she's got her degree. Let me see if I get it right. It's not just a big, long title. It's biomedical engineering. Is that right? Very good. So Alana is a beautiful young woman, and she has been, for the last several months until just recently, overseas with Ywam, which is Youth for a Mission. She's going to explain all this to you. And so instead of using her big whopper degree to make a lot of money right out of college, she's like given herself for a time to full-time ministry. So having been sent back a little early from her tenure over there because of all that's going on in the world, she's right now an intern at Parkland Chapel doing a bunch of behind-the-scenes stuff and some of the videos you see. And then she is, I'll steal a little bit of her thunder, she's going back full-time into ministry in January if everything opens up across the globe. So that said, I wanted her to share with you what's going on in her life, what happened during her trip. You're going to really be encouraged. But I want to do it not just because it's her. I want you to understand that as there's a bunch of unrest globally, and there's a lot of questions nationally, I think Christians who are supposed to have a lot of hope and a lot of joy are actually kind of, at least what I can see, locally, very kind of confused and concerned, and would just like things to go back to the way they were. And I don't know if that's ever going to happen, because I'm not so sure God liked how things were as much as we liked how things were. Now, all that said, I don't want to thumb wrestle with you guys over that. All I want to do is say that when you look at all the negatives that you can find on the Book of Face or whatever social media you look at or whatever news network, there's actually a ton of stuff going on spiritually. And anytime God's sifting, he's always raising up in the middle of things a faithful remnant. You guys represent that here this morning. And he's actually pushing faith up to the surface as he shakes everything else out. And so nationally, what's going on, and you can look this up on the worldwide interwebs, is that there is a youth revival happening. Specifically in Southern California, there are thousands of young people getting baptized in, you know, in the droves on the beaches. And locally, right here specifically, it's happened in our own youth group. So at a church camp just recently, we had several kids that came to the Lord. Many kids rededicate their lives. And not this coming Saturday, but the next one, the 15th, we will have our annual water park baptism. We want to invite you out to it because you get the water park, all the fun stuff for about an hour and a half after the baptisms, and we buy out the concession stand for you. But we have right now 15 people that are going to commit their lives to Christ, and many of those are under the age of 20. So, yeah, that's awesome. And Christianity is always one generation away from extinction. If the young people aren't empowered and emboldened and then given opportunity to share, then we snuff out the candle that begins to burn, and we want to make it burn brightly. So Alana represents a bunch of young people, not just here but all over. And so hopefully what's going to happen this morning is we're going to blow a little wind into the fire in Alana's life, and hopefully the same is going to happen for you. Okay, so give her a warm welcome. Come on, Alana.
All right, good morning. My name's Alana Warenberg, as Pastor Mike pronounced correctly. Very proud of that. My sister was called up for graduation, and they said, Shauna Warenberg, and her name's Shana. And we didn't even know it was her, so a little embarrassing there, but... if you remember way back when in October, if you were here, I gave a short little spiel about this thing I was going to do in New Zealand, and it was with Ywam, and I really had no idea what I was getting myself into. I just kind of knew this structure, and I was like, I'm going, I believe that Jesus called me. Yeah. So I came back roughly in one piece, and I'm just here to tell you about what God did in my life and what he's doing among the nations. So, a little bit about me, just to get to know me. I went to school at the College of New Jersey, which is in New Jersey. My mom also went there, and that is exactly the reason why I didn't want to go there. But, you know, God works in weird ways, so graduated in May of 2019, and with a degree in biomedical engineering. And so I studied abroad in Australia, actually my sophomore year of college. And I think that's where I really started getting a love for like the Pacific area over there in Australia and New Zealand. So some of my hobbies include videography, which you guys may be blessed with Sunday mornings, and you know, you don't see enough of my face, so there's a picture of me. I love anything outdoors. And then I like making spontaneous decisions, whether good or bad, but not like illegal bad. It just may be like driving in a snowstorm to get soup dumplings. Yeah. So my love languages are, if you're familiar with it, is quality time, closely followed by physical touch. But honestly, they all speak to me. Like, if you want to give me a gift, I'll feel very loved and encouraged. And then finally, soup dumplings. I really love those things. If you've never had them before, it's like a two for one. It's like a normal like dumpling, but then you get soup inside. So, you know, and I really think that anything in a pocket is just better. Okay, lingo. Just for you to help, or help you follow along a little bit more about some things that I may say, and to make my talk a little bit more cohesive. So YWAM is the overall organization that I was part of. It's Youth with a Mission, and they have a bunch of different schools that you can do. And so I did a DTS, or Discipleship Training School. And so basically, it's where you are discipled, you are trained, and you are schooled. Very self-explanatory, very nice and easy to figure out. And so they have bases all over the world. And if you look at the map, I don't know the numbers, but they're just all over the place and in nations that you probably wouldn't expect even. And the base that I was at was called Marine Reach. It's in Tauranga, New Zealand. It's in the North Island. And Marine Reach actually started off as a ship ministry. So if you're familiar with YWAM ship ministries, they have one of those that do like medical missions around the island. I think they were in the Caribbean whenever I was there. So I'll talk a little bit more about phases, but it's basically how we split up DTS while we're there. And then our school. So there are basically four sessions. Normally in every YWAM, there's like about four sessions. So they just kind of categorize it by the school. So I was October of 2019 because that's when our DTS started. And then finally, there are like these streams or what would be considered tracks that you can take. And we had four during our school. So we had pilgrimage, kingdom come, worship, and medical. And I was part of the medical team, or the medical stream. And finally, just as actual lingo that I picked up whenever I was abroad, so it's not like the bad word that you may think. It's like kind of like the metaphor, I would say, as a comparison, but it's really just put at the end of a word to like emphasize something. So a typical one is like sweet as, or like big as, or cool as. So if I drop that happen in this talk, like please know that that's what I'm referring to and not anything else that may be iffy. I wanted to clarify that before they never let me speak again. So again, DTS phases. So hopefully you can see the dates up there. Our lecture phase included, we were on base, Marine Reach, New Zealand, and we had basically 12 weeks, and each week we had a new topic, and we also had a different speaker. And so these topics included like relationships, hearing God's voice, lordship and repentance, Holy Spirit. So lecture is really just a time to look deeper into ourselves, what God has for us, and then also just to look and learn more about God and his character and his nature. Outreach is the next phase, and that's what you would typically consider a missionary trip, where we go into a foreign nation, you do missionary things, you take cute little pictures with little kids, and whatever else you would think a missionary does. And so I ended up going to Indonesia. Our school went to six different nations, which included Nepal, Thailand, Indonesia, Australia, Fiji, and Vanuatu. All beautiful places, and a great place to do mission work. So finally, we had reentry week, and that's just 1 week where we all come back together at Marine Reach's base, and we have some lectures in the morning, which we talk about what it's like to come back into our non-YWAM little circle and get back into our normal lives, and how do we talk about how we've changed, and some lies that may come up about that we haven't changed, or whatever else, like what it's like to just get back into the real world. We broke off some spiritual things that we may have carried back with us from our countries. And then finally we graduated, so we got this cute little certificate that says, you completed DTS, woohoo, which was cool. And so afterwards you're kind of free to do whatever. I got to travel New Zealand with some really awesome people, and some people just went home. So first week, we just go straight in here at this base. So we started with our life stories. So it's just telling what you've done in life, what, I don't know, life things have happened. And I found this quote very true from the very first week, even up until now. And so it says, gaining freedom is one fight, but staying in that freedom is a whole different fight. And so I'm reminded of this scene from Home Alone, Home Alone 1, where Kevin walks out and he's been told by his brothers that like that salt man is like really scary and something about dead bodies and whatnot. And he goes, I'm not afraid anymore. I tell you, I'm not afraid anymore. And then he sees that man and he gets a weird glare and he's like, and runs back into his house. That's kind of what this is in like when you're gaining freedom from something that's been holding you back. The devil likes to continuously like, hey, you didn't get freedom from that. You're going to fall back into that. So it's just constantly yelling, I don't have any fear. Then you might just have fear again. So much of Life Stories Week for us was just to learn about each other's backgrounds and just get a chance to understand each other a little bit more in a way of understanding. It's like if someone reacts a certain way or acts a different way than what you may expect, you know their life story, so you're like, oh, okay, like maybe that came from there. So it was a lot of crying, there was a whole lot of praying, emotions were up and down and all over the place, but ultimately it brought us really together as a school. And so for me, my fight, and I was gaining freedom from the fear of rejection. I'll go into that a little bit more in this as I continue to talk. So lecture phase was a lot of identifying fruit and digging up roots. So if you're a gardener, you understand that weeds come into your flower bed or like your tomato plants or whatever, and you need to get those out of there because it's not beneficial. And so you need to pull it up by the root or else they're going to keep coming back and bugging you and bugging your plants. And so some weeds may be harder than others, like dandelion weeds. Oh, I hate those. Those are the toughest weeds that I've like ever encountered. I don't think I've ever actually successfully pulled one up. I always had to call my mom to get it. And then there are like the little like clover-like things that are really easy to pull up, and you're like, hey, we got this. It makes me feel strong, gives you a little bit of self-confidence. But so in our lives, it kind of looks like stubbornness or independency or pride. And like none of these things are from God. And they usually occur in our lives because of a reason. So you can look at your stubbornness or your pride and like try to get rid of that just by itself. But if you look deeper into the reason why you may have that, then you're going to actually get somewhere. You're just going to, if you just look at the fruit, you're just going to keep going around in circles and continuously fighting the same thing. So for me, a personal example was perfect because they actually gave us a nice little worksheet with a tree and roots. So if you can read that, sorry it's a bit small, but I saw things on that fruit. And so for me, it was withdrawal, it was independency, the unable to be loved, and fear of deeper relationships. And there's probably more, but I'll just share that with you. I saw that and I knew that like I had this, and I had this for a while, but I questioned why. Like, I have a super great family life, I have really awesome friends, so why do I fear that my friends are gonna leave me? And so when we looked at the roots, number 5 really stuck out to me, and I'm like, okay, I think we're gonna get somewhere. And number 5 says being an adopted child. There's nothing wrong with being adopted. I love being adopted. It's a great life. I was told when I told my life story that there are like physical wounds, there are mental wounds, there are emotional wounds, and then there are finally spiritual wounds. And spiritual wounds run deeper than any of the other wounds. And so spiritual wounds in that I had this orphan spirit, and the orphan spirit is kind of like a wound of abandonment, and that I had to do life alone, and that you are by yourself, and you're alone. And so obviously that's not what Jesus taught, and that's not how we're supposed to live this Christian life at all. So for me, I got answers to like why I was feeling this way, but I also was just able to dig into the deeper spiritual like part of my adoption. And I never had like the opportunity or the time to just do that. So I just had space to question things. So this was something that was going on for like the entire 12 weeks of lecture phase, and probably, I don't know, still is. But we're learning from it and like identifying whenever lies pop up and then replacing that with the truth. So my favorite week, absolute favorite week, and probably most impactful week was when we learned about the Holy Spirit. We learned about the Holy Spirit a couple times, so I guess it's probably important. I mean, it's a part of the Trinity and a part of God. So my favorite part of the Holy Spirit, though, is the gifts of the Holy Spirit. And you can find that in 1 Corinthians 12 and 14. 14 talks more about tongues and prophecy, which is super awesome. And then finally, there's also Romans 12. So there's a list of them in both 1 Corinthians and Romans 12. And I have written in my Bible that Romans 12 is a power chapter. So if you want to feel empowered, or maybe it's you just get power, I don't know. It's a really awesome chapter. I encourage you to read it. It gives some great advice. And so I learned my gift that I grew most in was the gift of prophecy. And originally I'm like, prophecy? What is this? Like, that's Old Testament. You know, the prophets aren't here today. Like, that's almost like a weird word to say, you know. But I discovered that I was having these dreams, and they would come strangely, like, true. And I'm like, oh, what a coincidence. Turns out it was just God speaking to me. So I'm like, oh, okay, we'll see how to use this to encourage like people. And it's like, okay, now that we have this gift, like, how can I use it to build up the church and build up the communities that I'm in? And so we also were able to speak into each other's lives and identify like gifts that we may not see in ourselves. So someone would come up to me and be like, hey, I think you have wisdom. In fact, one of my friends, he came up to me, he's like, I see you as an old Asian man. I'm like, thank you. And he's like, well, you're not old and you're not Asian. No, you are Asian. And you are wise, but you are not old. I'm like, thank you. Really, very encouraging. No, it's a memory. So just in like, for us to pull life at each other, and to these gifts are meant to encourage the church. Like we're like the gift of prophecy is not meant to pull out your deepest lies and like shame you and whatever. That's not the gospel. But it's supposed to bring you up and like so that you guys can go out and do awesome things for Jesus too. Like you don't have to do it in a foreign country. You have your home, you have your children. And so these gifts, you are all given them. And you just sometimes you just need it brought out in you. I needed that, and it's all there. You just need it identified. So that kind of gives you a little snippet of what lecture phase was like, and my outtakes from it. So on to outreach. So outreach is determined. The teams are determined by the streams that we're in. So each track or each stream went to a different country. However, medical was split up because there were 29 students in the medical stream. And so if you try to take 29 students plus staff into a foreign country to do ministry, there's like too many cooks in the pot, or however that thing goes, the idiom. What? I don't know, I was not an English major. You just can't do it. So they split us up into three teams, and they told us team one, team two, and team three. They only gave us location for Indonesia just because it is a risky country to go into. And so they said, pray about it. And we already had hearing God's voice, so we knew how to hear God's voice and him telling us which team to go on. And we filled out our papers, our reason why, and then they went and prayed about it and split us up into teams as well. So I ended up on Indonesia. And so week one looked like just acclimating to the culture and to the heat. New Zealand really doesn't have much heat. I mean, much humidity, but Indonesia does. They're right on the equator. So that was something to get used to again. And then we were just establishing routine. So it was like team roles and how early we would wake up, who was doing dishes, who was like whatever else you do to establish routine. And then we did a lot of interceding and worship. And that was kind of to just get God's heart for our mission in these next 6 weeks. And then also just kind of getting our hearts set right to go out and do God's will. And then finally, this one actually ended up being very, very foundational. Like, you didn't realize how until, like, I explained, like, until, like, these 6 weeks continue on and building team unity. And this was just, if you look at that picture, there are 8 countries represented and a lot of strong personalities. And the thing is, probably on paper, we shouldn't have worked as well as we did. But and also, like, none of us were best friends, so that turned out actually really nice because, like, any two of us or any three of us could be together and have quality conversation, and we could all click with each other, and there were no, like, oh, these two are going off by themselves, we shouldn't, like, you know, whatever. But, like, the team unity was so important and crucial to our outreach, and so this is because the Sunday after we got there, we arrived on a Monday. The Sunday after, I also got to experience my birthday in Indonesia. I didn't know this, but you can put cheese on cakes. And it tastes good. What the heck? Like, weird. But, okay, Sunday we were just playing soccer in our backyard with our hosts. And so some of us were wearing shoes, like you should, and some of us were barefoot. Like, I was barefoot. So I was running after the soccer ball, and I just misstepped. And as I came down, my toes were pointed, and I landed all my weight on my toes. So I ended up breaking my foot. It's bones two, three, and four of my metatarsals were broken. I actually shattered the fourth one, so it looks really out of place. That's because it was. And now I have a nice 19 pieces of metal in my foot. I had surgery over there, which, I mean, can be scary, but we prayed about it and we had a lot of peace about staying over there. And it was just great because I was able to stay with the team. And so I'm all healed up now. I was 3 months on crutches, which for Americans is really long. And I had PT, so I'm all good now for the most part, with the occasional, like, you know, I feel old because my foot hurts with the weather. but, okay. So week two, if you look at this timeline, it could be defined by the ER. So Sunday, I break my foot. Wednesday, I go in for surgery and end up having surgery like 12 a.m. Thursday morning. And so then all Thursday, I'm just recovering from the anesthesia and like whatnot and like trying to eat and regain strength. And so one of my teammates actually comes into the ER and she has a fever and she's really tired and she might have chills or something like that. And like when you're in a foreign country like that, you don't mess with that. You have to go to the hospital. Like, you don't want to take the risk. So it turns out she had dengue fever. If you're familiar with that, transmitted by mosquitoes, it's really not treatable by medicine. You just have to ride it out. So she ended up getting some electrolytes and then was instructed to rest and stay cool, which is hard whenever you have, like, one very leaky air conditioning that kind of works. So that's Thursday. Saturday, another teammate comes down with the exact same symptoms, and we're like, oh no, like, she's like praying, dear God, please don't let it be dengue. I really don't want it to be dengue. And so she came in, and she was only diagnosed with a bacteria infection, and she's like, praise Jesus, it was only a bacteria infection. And it's kind of funny, because you look at it now, and it's like, only on outreach will you be excited that you have only a bacteria infection. So she's given antibiotics, and everyone recovered. And then Sunday, we were all back together. So you can look at this timeline. It was wild. Like, by the time that the third person came to the ER, the ER people just looked at my leader and were like, here are the papers, sign them. Yeah. But ultimately, we defined it as prayer. Because each one of those times that someone came sick, we prayed. We interceded for them. We prayed for healing. And like, God, what are you doing? And the thing is, although we were all separate and, like, we were still doing ministry, the team was still doing ministry, even though we had four people out, we had six people out, we were bonded together by something stronger than this earth. So we were all still together, even though we were apart. And honestly, it brought us together even more. So thankfully, after week two, we had no unexpected hospital visits. I did have to go to the hospital every week just to get checked up and to have my sutures out. But we got to do a lot of really cool ministry. So we went to orphanages and we went to schools where we taught health education. And we just played with the kids and had fun with them. We spoke at church and we spoke at youth groups. We also did four medical clinics since we were a medical team and gave people some free medicine and taught them how to take care of themselves. And then we also cleaned a mental health institute. And I wasn't there for this one, but the staff said that for us to come there and clean was one of the best things that had happened for them, and to really just love them in that practical way, because no one had come in to do the dirty work. It was gross, it was stinky, and it just, you know, we rocked those masks before masks were a thing, you know? And so for them to just be able to do that, it was a blessing for the people and for the staff. And then finally, I think something that wasn't necessarily considered a ministry, but was probably our biggest ministry, was that we were encouraging the missionaries that were already there. And so we get to come in for like 6 weeks, and some people, you know, we speak, and some people may give their lives to Jesus or rededicate their lives, but they're going to need to be discipled. And so those long-term mercenaries that are there, they're going to have the long-term impact. And so they don't usually get ministered to. So they also need encouragement and need to be loved on and know that they're doing a good job, because sometimes you forget when you're in ministry. One of the biggest and most impactful ministries that we had was actually with the middle schoolers. And this actually followed what was a flop of a ministry. I put that in quotes because really any ministry with God can turn that around, like, and just make it useful for his work. And there's lots of grace. And whenever we mishear him or like do something a little off the track. But so we did our health education with them. We played some games, had a fun little dance party. And then someone shared their testimony. And then we asked them all up for prayer. And so as kids do, like a couple came up and then they all came up and we're like, oh, well, okay. Like we didn't expect too much from it. We're just like, we'll pray for you. So as we started praying, they started dropping to the floor, crying and weeping. And we're like, oh my, like the Holy Spirit is there. And every single one of them, there was probably about 50 kids. And the thing is, you knew that the Holy Spirit was there. And this went on for about an hour. And if you think about it, it's about like 6th to 9th graders. And like in that age especially, you want to be cool. And like falling in front of your classmates crying is not necessarily considered cool these days. But, you know, the Holy Spirit works in such different ways. And it was so cool to just see this and experience it with them and just, see the work in young people. It's like Pastor Mark said, it's our next generation, even in a different country. And so while these kids were having their moment with the Holy Spirit, I was also having a moment with the Holy Spirit. I was sitting off to the side, as I like typically do, just because I can't stand for long periods of time on crutches. And I was like, okay, I think I may go over and like lay my hand on some of these kids and pray for them. And so I'm like, God, should I go over and get up? And he's like, no, don't go. And I'm like, what? Like, why shouldn't I go over and pray for these kids? It can't be bad. He's like, no, don't go, just stay. And I'm like, okay, but I really want to be part of this action. And he's like, you are, just not in the way that you think you are. And so in that moment, I realized the reason why I broke my foot. And I had been asking God for this for a while. This event that I'm talking about happened in about week 5. I broke my foot week 1. And so I'd been questioning for a while. And I wasn't going to question. I was just going to accept it and move on with life. But I was encouraged to ask God, why? Why me? Why my foot? Why now? The timing? Why? And so it was cool because I realized that if I had been fully physically capable, I would have marked the success of outreach by it, what I could have done measurably. So if I would have preached a certain amount of times or prayed for a certain amount of people or, you know, played guitar a certain amount of times, I would have been like, okay, we did good. Outreach was a success. But with my physical ability taken away, I had to invest more emotionally and spiritually. And if I did have my foot, like I would have missed out on that part. And that, and emotionally and spiritually, is probably way better than any physical ability that I can do, because it's not my power, then it's Jesus' power. And so I was like, okay, God, that's a good answer. I can accept that and move on with life. And so along the way, I also had a bunch of other little lessons along, just that I knew that were like, these are good reasons why I broke my foot, but it wasn't the big reason. And so I learned to be present in that country. And when I first got there, I didn't necessarily want to be there. There were mice in our accommodation. The food was a little bit weird. It was humid. And like none of the people on my team were my best friends. And so I just really missed them as well. But after being in the hospital for 5 days with one person, which was really great and a great bonding experience, but I was like, I just really miss the team. And I miss being able to go out and explore a different country and minister to these people. And I was just kind of had a little bit of like missing out, like FOMO, but it's like, okay, I'm stuck here. And then we learned how to pray for healing. And in that, like when I first broke my foot, we prayed for a miracle that when they opened my foot, took the x-ray, the bones would be miraculously put back together and they wouldn't have to do any surgery. And obviously that didn't happen, but that doesn't mean that prayers stopped. We just continued praying for the next thing. So the next thing was that my foot would heal quickly because I couldn't be in a hard cast to be able to fly back to New Zealand. And I wanted to get back to New Zealand. And that prayer was answered. I never had a hard cast. I only had an ACE bandage. And so the faith never dropped, and the prayers didn't stop. We just learned to pray for different things. And so if you're praying for healing, and you know God says no, ask him what's next. And then these last three kind of go hand in hand almost, but I learned to ask for help. I didn't have crutches for a week and a half after I broke my foot. So anything outside my reach, I needed to ask people to grab it for me, or to go to the bathroom, or even just to move from my bed to the main room. And I like doing things by myself. I really do. And so I had to have some humility to just be like, okay, I can't do it. I'm not going to try. And the thing is, I also saw that my team was so good in that, not making me feel like a burden or anything, but they wanted to help me, and they wanted me to ask, and they didn't want me to try to do it by myself because I could injure myself more. And they did it all out of love. And it wasn't because it was an obligation or they were getting paid to do it. It's because they loved me. So I learned humility. I learned what it meant to be carried, both literally and figuratively. And you can see from this really cool picture, I was carried around a lot. We didn't figure out how to go upstairs until after I had to go up all the stairs. I was like, oops. They didn't really give us instructions on how to use crutches. That's actually useful to know how to use crutches. And finally, I learned how to be weak in front of people. And I think it's a lot easier to be weak and vulnerable and cry in your bed. Maybe your dog's there. But to be weak in front of others, that's a whole different ballgame. And so, one time I did break down. I'm like, I have no idea what's happening to me, or why this happened to me, and it really sucks. But the ability to be weak in front of others is something that, and I don't like crying at all. And so I was encouraged that in order for me to show strength, or to show weakness, it required a lot of strength. And so I really understood what Paul meant in 2 Corinthians 12, where he says, "My grace," meaning God's grace, "is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect," my power meaning God's power, "is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weakness, so that Christ's power may rest on me. For when I am weak, then I am strong." So that was a little summary from outreach and my perspective. If you ask anyone else from my team, it looks a lot different, and they kind of get the other end of what it meant to care for someone or sacrifice. And it was really cool to hear their testimonies, even though I lived that with them. So as I said, we did it re-entry, we graduated, and then I got to travel. And then I came home in the midst of a pandemic on crutches. It was real great because I got upgraded to Economy Plus. Not that I need the foot room, but my friend that was traveling with me, he was 6-something, it was really nice. So what's next? As Pastor Mike kind of hinted, I have been accepted officially back to staff at Marine Reach in New Zealand. And hopefully that'll happen in 2021, but if it doesn't, okay, there's a plan there. But I do hope it does, but who knows. And so I will be on the media team. And so media is not typically considered missions, but as times change and technology changes, so do the way we do missions. And so for my heart behind this is to be able to allow students to be fully present. There are so many moments on DTS that you want to capture. But the thing is, if you're trying to capture those moments and you're not being invested in, and you're not getting that everything that you can from God and from the program that you have been called to. And so for me, taking pictures, doing videos and that, I'm not necessarily qualified, and honestly, I didn't even want to go back to staff. I went into DTS, I'm like, I'm not coming back to do staff. I'm not going to be one of those students, but here I am. And so those projects and those videos and those pictures will be something that students can take back with them and show their family and their friends and their sponsors and be like, hey, this is what I did. This is what this country looks like. And then it'll also be an opportunity for them, in 10 years out from DTS, that they can look back at a picture and be like, oh, I remember what God did during that. And so it's an encouragement for them to be like, hey, remember this time when God worked. So how can you help? Prayer, obviously, is very foundational to everything, and things don't go as planned, as my outreach is a prime example of it. And so prayer for that, and also practical. So anything encompassing staff, from finances to safety to visas to the borders opening again so you can actually get back there. And then secondly, financials. So Ywam is actually all staffed by volunteers, so everyone actually pays to be there. So you don't go into Ywam to make money. You go in there to invest in people, and so it's not free. And honestly, I'm not up here. I didn't come up here to ask you for money or to like support me, because whether or not people do, like, it will happen somehow, and I have the faith that God will provide. But I do ask you that. To just pray about whether this is something that that you can be involved in missions. And like, the reason why I broke my foot, it may not be the way that you think you should be in missions. Like, you may want to be on the front lines, but that's not what God has called you to do. You may question why, and it's like, okay. But hey, I just ask that as I've been faithful to my calling, that you be faithful to your calling. In missions, whatever that may look like, and know that your missions is not necessarily going out into a foreign country, but right here at home. So now that you heard that I actually did things while I was abroad, and I didn't just have fun and travel and do cool things, and I didn't skydive this time, but I still broke my foot. Okay, I do have a video that I want to show you guys, just to kind of put some images and videos to what I did, and you'll see Indonesia and you'll see New Zealand. They're beautiful countries. And so if you want more information, I'll be in the foyer after service. I have a couple sign-up sheets if you want to just sign up for updates, or if you're even interested in supporting me financially. There's no commitment at all. I'm still just figuring all this out, the logistics of everything, just because like I just found out like 2 weeks ago, and then I'm doing this. I'm like, oh, well, I might as well throw it out there. So yeah, I'll be in the foyer afterwards, and yeah, I'll pray, and then we'll run this video. So God, we just thank you for this time, and God, just to hear about what you're doing in the nations and in people across the world. We thank you for how good you are, and that you work even when we don't see it, or that we question why. And God, that you work when the devil tries to thwart your plans, and that you turn it all around for good. And so God, I pray that you bless these people this week as they are in their mission, and God, that you would bring out their spiritual gifts, and that they would have people in their lives that speak life into them and encourage them and bring that out. God, I just pray that everyone is encouraged today and may go out knowing that you are still good and that you are constant in the midst of crazy times, and God, that you're still working when we don't see and we don't feel it. Yeah, we thank you and we love you. Amen.
If I told you this was only gonna hurt, if I warned you that the fire's gonna burn, would you walk in? Would you let me do it first? Do it all in the name of love. Would you let me lead you even when you're blind? In the darkness, in the middle of the night, in the silence, when there's no one by your side, would you call in the name of love? Trust me when you're jumping from the heights. Would you fall in the name of love? When there's madness, when there's poison in your head, when the sadness leaves you broken in your bed, I will hold you in the depths of your despair. But it's all. testify, screaming the holy lie. You bring me back to life, and it's all in the name of love. I wanna testify, screaming the holy light. You bring me back to life, and it's all in the name of love. In the name of love. Name of love. In the name of love. Name of love. In the name of love.
Why don't you all stand up? And that was wonderful, Alana. Thank you very much for sharing all that. Let's close tonight, or this morning. We're gonna sing one more song. All right. Let's sing this together.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name.
Let's sing that again.
My hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly trust in Jesus' name. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in the Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord, Lord of all. When darkness seems to hide His face, I rest on His unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. Oh, my anchor holds within the veil. Christ alone, cornerstone, weak made strong in Savior's love. Through the storm, He is Lord. Shall come with a trumpet sound. Oh, may I then in Him be found, dressed in His righteousness alone. Faultless stand before the throne. Christ alone, cornerstone, we Lord.
All right. Thank you guys so much for attending today. If you need prayer, I'll be stationed over here as normal. If not, we want to make sure we invite you. If you have not been baptized, come up and talk to me, and we'll take care of that here on the 15th. I'd love for you to get to profess your faith publicly the way the Lord identified with us. If not, you don't need any of those things, then we'll see you next week. God bless.